Welcome to the Public Voice Salon. We are an open dialogue on education, the arts, and social change. And we are here today. We have such an amazing guest, Mr. Robert Cenedella, who is the bad boy of the art world, who has suddenly become very popular. It's about time, I will say that. Robert has there's a movie out about him called The Art Bastard. He has thumbed his nose at the art world for decades. And we're going to learn the secret of his craft. We're going to learn something about Robert and his creativity. He's also a wonderful teacher. He teaches at the Art Students League. So this man is a very fascinating person. He's out there on tour with his movie now, and we're so grateful to be with him and spend some time with him. Robert, let's start with your reputation of being kind of a rebel. How did that come about?
Well, it came about just by doing things that I thought were right, actually, starting with my article satirizing the atom bomb drills at the High School of Music and Art, which I then printed and handed out to 2,000 students and all the faculty. But I never felt more right in what I did. And yet, it was the basis of my being expelled. But that was a good thing, in a way, because that's how I met George Gross.
Talk about George Gross.
So, yeah, well, had I not been expelled, I might have eked my way into even a college. I'm not sure. But without a high school diploma, I wasn't really thinking about college. So I went to the Art Students League, which the only requirement is that you want to learn how to draw, paint, sculpt, or printmake. So because of that, I met a man named George Gross, who I didn't know who he was at the time, but he was expelled from Germany. He was actually chased out of Germany by Hitler. He predicted what Hitler would become, and anyway, he just, the day after he left for America, they raided his studio in Berlin, so he had a premonition. And maybe I've had a premonition about art since the beginning also, not sure.
Well, one of your works is behind us here, and as people can see, there's a vibrancy, there's a vitality, there's the color, there's the humanity, there's a sense, to me, of community, of connection, of people engaged in discussion, engaged in the public square. And we were talking earlier about this phenomenon of our time, of people becoming more isolated. We talk a lot about this on our show, of the alienation that's permeating our society. You came to New York at a time when Times Square was a bustling place, you know, that was vital and full of characters. How did New York of that time period, like the 60s and 70s, how did that influence your work?
Well, tremendously, really. It was, to me, New York was a place to learn. I mean, I came to New York, I was about 12, but it opened up all kinds of doors intellectually, every way. And speaking of Times Square, there is really where you got street smart. And what I find interesting is that they, under the various mayors, mostly Bloomberg, you know, cleaning up Times Square. Mm. I mean, now we have the kind of smut that you can sell openly, like Victoria's Secret or these big, huge, screens with all, you know, it's a different kind of smut. It's a kind of smut that they can make money on and so on. I liked it in the old days when you found your little peep shows and you learned that way, but it wasn't, they weren't trying to sell underwear or bathing suits in. So anyway, so it was authentic. Times Square was authentic. Now it's really a mall at this point, a kind of mall without any real values or from what I can see. You couldn't learn much as a kid there now, except that they like to show women with hardly anything on, and then they call it some kind of, you know, that's some kind of cleansing of a truly great area that now is really just very bland and very uninteresting.
Well, this is something that is also at the heart of my pedagogy as an educator, which is boringness, this idea of critiquing the banality of our society and how art can wake us up and make us feel more alive and give us visions of a world that might be a better world, a more utopian future that might be, a world of possibilities. John Dewey said that the aesthetic is the opposite of the anesthetic, and it's the anesthetic that puts us to sleep, but the aesthetic wakes us up. And when I look at your work, I feel this exuberance, this vitality of life, of joy vivre. You know, you have a wonderful canvas of a bar down on Broome Street that is just so kaleidoscopic in its vitality. And maybe we could talk a little bit about bars, too, because, you know, people can see we each have a beer in front of us right now. And I want to give a toast to your great mentor, George Gross, who you said taught you, not only taught you how to draw, but taught you how to drink. Okay. Now, George's dad owned a pub in Germany. I did some research and I found that out. Does that affect your thinking in terms of going to bars and talking to people and engaging in discussion and dialogue? How does that permeate your work?
Well, I think it's sort of similar to the old Times Square. I look at bars as sort of like each time you go into a bar, it's like being part of a one-act play, you know? And there you meet people, you talk much more openly. I mean, just think of when you go into a gallery, you know, you're kind of supposed to be quiet.
Oh, yeah.
And you're supposed to, you know, and
right.
not, you know, don't make any waves, that kind of thing. So, whereas a bar opens up your,
yes.
And you might meet people that you don't like, you might people, you know, more often than not, I find that after a couple of beers, you make many more friends after a couple of beers than before you have. But so bars are it's also a great place to show work because the atmosphere is totally different and people, you're not feeling self-conscious. And I know that Thomas Hart Benton always said he'd much rather show in a bar than a museum. That's one of the quotes that I keep in the back of my mind. It justifies my my frequency of going to bars.
That's good. Let's get into a little controversy here now, because back in the 60s, when pop art became all the rage, and Andy Warhol was like the one, he was like the number one guy back then, you came along and you created a one-man show called Yes Art. This was your answer to pop art. You had a one-man exhibit called Yes Art, and you basically thumb your nose at Warhol, and that wound up being very popular, and you achieved a certain notoriety for that. Can you educate our audience a little bit about what happened?
Sure. Yeah. All right, I was really rather depressed about having spent a lot of time with a great man like George Gross, learning how to draw, learning how, you know, and I saw as I started my career, this was the beginning of when you had abstraction going into pop. And art, it was less important than the promotion. So I was going to do my farewell to the to art by having this exhibition, in which I said, I predicted that I would get more publicity than any artist in New York, including Andy Warhol, and I did. So instead of, you know, I think at that time he was painting pictures of S&H green stamps, and instead what I did was I signed a contract with the S&H green stamp company, and we gave out S&H green stamps with the sale of art. Okay, and that had never been done before. And of course, it'll probably never be done again. I did it as a joke, but it was taken seriously, pretty much like the entire show. My whole show was done in a way that even the critics weren't quite sure. They thought that this might be the next movement, you see. But the people that got it were people like Murray Kempton, you know, not bad, you know, Victor Levasky, Dick Schaap and Marvin Kittman, people like that. They were journalists.
Yes.
Journalists who, but the art community, you know, really was a little bit wary, even though I think John Cannaday did a piece on it and Grace Gluck, and neither one of them really understood it. But they were also, you know, like in today's art world, your critics have to be supporting the hand that feeds them, and the hand that feeds them has really little to do with art. It has to do with how to make money, and I don't see that art and money really mix in the end. It's really not a thing.
You know, you mentioned Marvin Kittman, and we saw Marvin Kittman last night in the documentary that we watched, the wonderful documentary about your life called The Art Bastard, which is playing across the country now. You're on tour. You've suddenly become famous at the age of 76, which is, you know, God bless you. I think that's wonderful. But, you know, a long time coming, even though you were famous to an extent back then, but this is a level of fame that I think is well-deserved. Marvin Kittman is one of my heroes as well, because he also ran for president of the United States, and I ran for president in 2012, which was mostly a kind of a fun consciousness-raising thing where I went around the streets and I handed out my flyers. So when I saw that Marvin ran, I said, all right, Marvin. And I sent him an email today, and I told him that I saw him on the show, and he said, say hello to Robert for me. So for Marvin, he's a good guy. You know, this book here that's in your wonderful studio here on 38th Street, this is the American President series. I want to just show it. This is an old encyclopedia that I used to have in my home. My mom had bought this for us when I was a kid. I grew up with this book in my house. And I notice also on your wall, there's a photograph of FDR. So politics has really permeated your artistic work in life as well. I see that. Our show is about education, the arts, and social change. We try to mix that up. Talk a little bit about how you developed as a political being and some of the influences on that and how that may have shaped your artwork.
Well, I think the main one was my father, or the one that brought me up. Cenedella was the head of the Radio Writers Guild, and we were doing quite well. He wrote for Helen Hayes and he was then called by McCarthy to answer the question, are you now, or have you ever been a member of the Communist Party? So he said, it's none of your business. And wouldn't sign the oath, and he was blacklisted, and so politics became a feature of right and wrong, but also living well and living in poverty, and we really did live in a kind of poverty from the time that happened. So right from the start. And I don't see how politics cannot be. I mean, it permeates the society. You can't get away from it. You put your head in the sand, but it's kind of hard to avoid the kind of things that, you know, now most recently, my new hero, Donald Trump. Oh. Now he's, this is, you know, this is, going to be, this is, yeah, I have to say, it used to be that George Bush was my hero, but now I have to, you know, it's going to Donald Trump. So I'll do everything, and I hope everyone else does everything to make sure that this man does not get into the White House. That would be a tragic thing. But we're always having to fight this kind of thing, whether it's Bush, whether it's, there's always someone out there. There's always going to be the enemy, I guess. Yeah?
Yes, yes. You talked about your dad. You talked about, this something in your family, which I think a lot of people have to a certain extent, is dysfunctional families. And in your case, it was particularly dramatic because you were 6 years old when you found out that the person you thought was your father was not your dad. Your mom had a couple of drinks, she was a little tipsy, and she actually told you that your real father was an English professor who she had an affair with. And so this then, you know, this psychological aspect came into your life, this pain. How did that affect your work? Because we like to think a lot about psychology and art. And did you find that your work is a way of healing and sort of, you know, healing yourself from that pain? Or?
Totally. I mean, there's a couple of paintings that were in the film, one called Father's Day, in which I thought I was doing a satirical painting on boxing. I've always thought boxing is a little bit, you know, two people beating each other up. That is a little strange to begin with, right? So, but when I made these boxers middle-aged men with big bellies and this kind of thing, gray hair, it was the satire or humor was a little bit more obvious. But while I was doing this, the drawing for the painting, I see one of the fathers is clearly, you know, coming out on the canvas, and it actually led me to then say, well, Jesus, this is like an opportunity to have both of them on the same canvas, and I think, as I said in the movie, so I have them, you know, here they are punching each other. And I was the one getting hurt, that's therapy. That's therapy on the canvas, in my opinion. That kind of thing.
But then George Gross entered your life, and he became a mentor to you. I think mentoring is so important in this world for all of us to find mentors. As a teacher myself, that we mentor the young, and in some way the young mentor us, that it becomes a sort of a back and forth relationship. You actually tried to sneak on a boat to Europe to follow your great mentor and teacher, George Gross, over to Germany. Talk about, that's a dramatic story in itself.
Yeah. Well, as much as what I can remember, we had been both, as you mentioned, he taught me how to drink, and now he's going back to Berlin, and he's not really wanting to go back, and we've had so many cocktails at that point, but I was quite serious about the idea when he suggested that I get in the closet and not wait until the fall of that year, which is I was going to go and see him anyway. So I did get into the closet, and when the boat was out in the middle of the Hudson, the wife discovered me, and I was let off the side of the boat, brought to the shore, and that's it. That was history, because two weeks after he got back, or 3 weeks after he got back to Berlin, he died. So that was the last time I saw him. So that dramatic time made, even that had a big effect on someone who's always in search of Dada. I use that as a bit of a pun, you know. He was the Dadaist movement, and I had a show in Berlin called In Search of Dada, And the double meaning was, you know, George Gross was the first adult that I ever respected. And so, you know, he played a big part in my life.
Wow. Well, Dada turns 100 this year. So that's an anniversary that's very special. And Marcel Duchamp is another famous Dada influence, Dada person who I understand went up to the top of the Washington Square Arch and had a picnic and declared that Greenwich Village was an independent country. So in the Dada movement, you know, it's acts that you commit in public that can also be works of art, and it's reimagining what art might be. But when you look out there today and you see, Robert, these paintings that are going for $50-100 million, and you look at them and you say, what is it, you know, what is that? What is going on with that? What is going on with, like, Jeffrey Koons and his work that's very manufactured? What would you say to Jeffrey Koons if you had a conversation and you could, say, confront him on this?
Well, I would prefer not to. I mean, I have such loathing for a man who has not just commercialized the world, but the art world, but the idea that he kind of boasts about the fact that he can't draw, he cannot paint, and yet he insists that he is so in tune with artistic expression that he can tell someone else to make something and that it's his. Then he signs it without no problem. He signs it and so on. Well, okay, it's utterly foolish on the one level, and I would point. I guess I might point out to him that most of what he's done, I did in 1965 in Yes Art, because everything that I did as a joke, including having a live sculpture, which Warhol did 10 years later, and it was like looked at as some new, you know. So the gimmick in art is, that's what it is now. Art is a gimmick. And to spend $57 million or $60 million on a painting by a contemporary artist is also a gimmick. Now, I would like to see the signed checks. See, I'm not so sure any of this ever goes down the way they say it is. I just have no regard for Jeff Koons at all. And I actually had postcards made that were sent to the Frick Museum when he was giving a talk, and I sent it to the curator of the Frick Museum. They got so many cards, people agreeing with me. I don't know, can I use the word?
Be careful, because we really have to bleep it out.
Yeah, okay. Don't give S ... a bad name.
Okay.
So many people agreed with me that he got hundreds and hundreds of postcards, and then when he was going to have his talk, I showed up because I wanted to shake his hand, and I wanted to meet him because I wanted him to know that I had sent these cards and that I had a point of view. And what happened was that they had the police. There were police cars, thinking that this was a big movement, and it was just one. Me and a couple of my students, Jeff Tochi and Murray Miller, were there helping me in this little cause. But here they were already, and then the cop said that I was littering, and he could put me in jail. When he heard what my views were on Jeff Koons, he said, you know what, I agree with you. And he let me off.
The judge did.
The judge.
Amazing. Wow. You know, he might be a bad influence on me, Claudia. You better be careful, you know. But now I'm looking around the room and I see Dow 2001. That's another one of your famous, sort of a prank. You're sort of an art world prankster in a way, too. What happened with Dow 2001?
Well, this was the, like a lot of my work, on the one hand, it was satiric. I was offering for the first time shares of stock in a single painting. That had never been done before. And I did it legally through the SEC with the producer of the movie, Chris Concannon. And he's a financial printer, so we had to do it legally. And if you do it legally, you have to sell all the stock in a very short time. We didn't make the boat. But the idea, the concept got written about in the Times and the Wall Street Journal and all across the world, really. So that the, I often say, I point out that I'm the most widely written about unknown artist in America. And that's been a part of my, you know, my history. But okay. Now I'm with film. Uh-huh. It seems that I'm not just widely written about, but they now can see. They're forced to look at the art, and it seems like a lot of people like it. So
I'd like to give a shout out to my dad, Jack Braden, who's a former actor and a painter. I am the son of a painter, and he lives down in Ocean Grove, New Jersey, with my mom. And he likes to call himself an internationally ignored artist. So power to those who are the internationally ignored artist. I consider myself an internationally ignored talk show host. So you give us hope. You give us hope, Robert. You really do. Now, my dad painted his first picture when he was 48 years old. He never went to school, okay? I'm an educator, and I'm a troublemaker also as a teacher. I'm always getting into trouble as far as teaching outside the box, running afoul of administrators who want to administer a cookie-cutter curriculum and follow the textbook, which is boring, and I never use a textbook, and I don't care who sees me say this. You know, I always use my own stories, my life. I bring in, you know, excerpts from books. We watch movies. We dialogue, and my classroom teaching is like a one-man show, you know? Great. But it's fun, and it's a lively... But the idea, when I saw that you're at the Art Students League, I didn't realize that the Art Students League has no grades, and they don't give any degrees. It's just you go there for a time, and you study, and you grow. And I think this could be a great model for our educational system to emulate, you know. And so you are a wonderful teacher. I saw your excerpts of your teaching in this film, Art Bastard. Talk a little bit about that, about how you developed as a teacher and what gives you joy about teaching.
Yeah, well, teaching is... not just a way of giving back, but you get as much, if you do it right, you get as much from your students as you give them. I started, when I taught, it was really, another kind of ironic, I had a big, well-publicized show at Saatchi & Saatchi, and this was the show where they took out my Santa Claus on a cross painting, the crucified Santa Claus, which again became very well written about, but not by the art community, but throughout. It's a painting that went viral once it was finally shown, and where it was shown was at the Art Students League 10 years after it had been censored by Saatchi & Saatchi. So, and that happens to be the year that I started teaching, because as a result of the promotion to the Saatchi show, Rosina Florio at the league calls me up and says, "Bob, this is Rosina. Remember me? I hadn't seen her since 1957, 59 when I left with Gross," and she says. I said, and then I sort of did. She was the secretary at the time. She had now become the head of the school. And she says, "How would you like to teach the old George Gross?" And I went silent, and she says, "Say yes." I said, "Yes." And 2 days later, I meet her, and I'm teaching at the league completely, you know, just out of the blue. But so one really... bad experience of having to have that painting, which the show was built around, taken out, led to my teaching at the league.
Wow. Well, tomorrow I'm actually teaching a seminar called The Magical Power of Big Dream Stories at the Symposia Bookstore in Hoboken. and I think I will mention you because you certainly have followed this dream, and you've pursued it, and you've gotten this far. And what could you say to our people watching our show who have a big dream? I find a lot of people these days are not going for their big dreams because of the reality of life, the economic realities, which could also be changed, right? When we think about what is reality and what could be different, I think, what is it? How can people who want to be creative, who want to become actors or writers or artists, how can they stay strong with their creativity despite all of the, you know, this reality of having to make a living and
Well, one thing that I learned from seeing the movie, because when I took the job, I went into the advertising to avoid the commerciality of the art world. So now I go in and I am now here I am in an advertising agency. But I realized that the reason I was there was not to make a profession out of, but it was just to make money so I could paint. So in other words, the artist has this terrible dilemma that you, if you have a 9-to-5 job, how do you, you know, so my only answer is that is that you don't give up your day job, but you try to, but whatever art you do, whatever endeavor you take, you don't go to the marketplace. You paint for yourself. You write for yourself. You whatever you're doing, it should be something that you. In other words, you don't want to bastardize your art. You can do that in any other aspect of your life, but not your art. And I say, and that's why I say, why be an artist then? And it's never going to be easy, but the reward is that. When you are looking at what you've done and you know that it's where you want it, that's the reward. And I would just say never think of earning your living from your work. If you can do it, that's fantastic. But don't have that be the goal. Find another way to make money and then... be very totally true to your art. That's my advice.
Do you think that art can change the world?
Yeah, I think real art can change the world. I think we know that the still image, what I call the still image. For instance, we had what, thousands of hours in Vietnam, right, of people seeing Hill number 27 or 266, and we see death, destruction, napalm, and so on. On the other hand, if you think of the photograph of the students at Kent State, the girl, I think back and I get emotional about just thinking of that girl over her friend who had been shot and killed. Okay, now this was an act that Richard Nixon, that he had the but that photograph, that still image, sticks in my mind. And all the footage of the film never, you know, you kind of know it was there. But so I think that that paintings. I think that the eventually my Santa Claus painting, you know, if it were hanging in a museum, and people saw it, they saw it for what it really is. That still image says so much about our society. If you look at it right, instead of people said, "Oh, you're making fun of religion," I said, "What are you talking about?" I said, "Who replaced Christ with Santa Claus as your symbol of this great of the most important religion in the world?" Right. So I do think that that art, if it's shown, and the problem we have now is like what I say on my poster. I said, it's not what they show that bothers me, it's what they don't show. And so censorship is alive and well and becoming more and more, it's in every aspect of our lives at this point.
One person I think you would be very interested in is a guy named Reverend Billy, who has a church of Stop Shopping. And he also, you know Reverend Billy?
Yeah, with his white suit and, I love him. I love the guy.
He tends to be a preacher, yeah. You know. Fantastic. And he came up, he made a movie called What Would Jesus Buy, which is also a critique of the over-commercialization of Christmas. And so the two of you guys, I think, would have a lot to say to each other. What's interesting, Robert, is how you publicize, how you have a knack for publicity. Now, this happened early on. You were not a big fan of Elvis, okay? And I won't hold that against you because I do love Elvis. But you know, there were these I like Elvis buttons, and you came up with an I like Ludwig button because you like classical music and Beethoven, and which became a huge, huge hit. You know, big. You made a lot of money from that. Later on, when you got into advertising then in the 70s, when you did this thing about Nixon, you had dartboards that people could take out their frustrations by throwing darts at a picture of, like, Richard Nixon, and that became another bestseller. And in fact, you wrote a letter to Nixon. You had the audacity to write a letter to Nixon, and you said, Dear Mr. President, you know, we have your face on a dartboard, but we would like a better photograph. And he sent you a photograph. So with all that being said, don't you think, I mean, that people who are politically progressive need to really have a knack for getting their word out there, their ideas out there in a bigger way? You have that ability to do that. So what do you think?
Well, it's sort of out of necessity that I, and I really like, I mean, I really believe in capitalism, but capitalism doesn't believe in itself. See, we have capitalism for right now for the poor, and we have socialism for the rich, and this is borne out by the when you take the bail out all the biggest banks in America. And you bail them out. You say, well, why? Well, that's because they're too big to fail. Well, that's what they always, that's the complaint about socialism. They say, oh, no, every man must make it on his own. And so they're not going to bail out some guy who's had a restaurant or a shoe store or something wasn't making it. No, they bail out the big guys. And I've always used capitalism sort of against itself, and that's and by that I mean that like the white trash can that I did of George Bush, big picture of Bush and said white trash on it. Okay, now this would have been a big seller in the 70s or the 80s, but in 2012 or 15 when I did it, stores would not handle a thing like this. It would be politically incorrect. Whereas Macy's was selling the dartboards, and they couldn't get enough of them. Johnson, Reagan, you know, the whole group of them. So I believe in free enterprise, but free enterprise doesn't believe in me, and that's really the struggle for it's over the years. You know, when I had my dart boards, I had posters, I had, humor has been my a weapon in a sense. And even humor in art is very, you go back and you say Bruegel, you go Daumier, you go, you can count them on your finger. Political art and humor is in art is a very difficult but and it's something that's harder and harder to do today because the concept of art is something that's very serious. I mean, let's face it, if you're gonna hang a painting of a soup can in your living room, you have to take that seriously, or you just see it for what it was, which is like a kind of a bad joke.
No. Wow. I always like to give a shout out to Judson Memorial Church in Greenwich Village, which is a place that has inspired me and transformed me as a great intersection of spirituality and radical politics and art. That's the first place where Robert Rauschenberg displayed his work. The art world just didn't know what to do with this guy Rauschenberg when he came up, and they said, Judson, you know, they said, you can put your work here. That's the first place that had, the first church that had naked people dancing in the mid-60s. There was a big controversy at Judson, okay, with Reverend Moody, who, by the way, Reverend Moody is in the Atlantic magazine this week. There's a whole profile on Atlantic on Reverend Moody and how he was getting abortions for women for free. You know, so Judson Memorial Church had that radicality. Yoko Ono used to perform there in her early work and stuff. So what do you think about Rauschenberg? Is he someone who's, did you know Robert Rauschenberg, or was that, would that be work that wasn't really interesting for you? Or
I didn't know him. And again, I say it's not what they show that bothers me, it's what they don't show. So I think he was part of the rise of abstract expressionism, which then dominated the art world for, you know, to a point where if you were a representational painter, you just were not taken seriously. And that's precisely when I went into the art world. So I would never have any problem I have with an artist in particular. Well, Jeff Koons is a separate case because, or the, you know, the shark in the Metropolitan Museum of Art, which really belongs in the Museum of Natural History, as far as I can see. But so these again are gimmicks, and these are, so they permeate the system to the point where there's like everything else in this country there's nothing in the middle. You got either like it or I hate it. And so that's sort of what's, unfortunately, with the art, they promote only what they, it's so controlled by that you don't have the chance to, so that kind of art, it's not that I don't like it, I just don't do it. But it's the over, it's just seeing one kind of thing rather than having an open field. I'm sure there's so many artists that feel that way, and it's the system itself that has to be changed. It's
wow. Yeah. So it seems as if the whole system is being corrupted by big money, not only the political process after Citizens United, when you have to have a lot of money to run for president. I didn't get too far in my campaign. I'm sure Marvin didn't get too far either. In fact, I didn't. I got no votes. And people say, people tell me, why didn't you vote for yourself? And I say, well, I was ambivalent about my campaign. I don't think I'd want to be president.
No, I would have voted for you. And I know I voted for Marvin.
Okay.
And but he wrote a book. He wrote a book about running for president. And so you might try it again. Look at Bernie. He did pretty well, right? He started off with almost nothing, and who knows if the independents had been able to, if their votes had been counted, this guy might have been he might have been number one. So that's something we should remember.
Wow. Count those votes now. Make sure you go back to Brooklyn. What happened to those votes? Robert, talk about your friendships. You have said that you have all kinds of friends in different circles everywhere but the art world, right? Everywhere but the art world. Why is that? Why is it hard for you, or why do you think it's hard for others to make friends within the art world? Is there like a shallowness there, or is it like too backstabbing? Or?
Well, as a young student, I had I followed in the tradition of Thomas Hart Benton, all the people from the WPA who actually painted together. They could be very different. You know, Diego Rivera could be with George Gross, and they're both political painters, but they're different. They're you know, Ben Shahn. So there was a sense of of learning from each other, and you weren't competitive. This was not a competitive in the sense that it is today, and it's competitive to the today because it's all about money. But I pose a problem because I don't go along with the game you have to play to be successful in the art world. So they, even though my politics would be, and let's face it, they have kept politics out of their art. And that's not by accident. That's not by accident.
Okay.
Why can Nelson Rockefeller be a collector of art all of a sudden? All right? Why? He wasn't, his father, took Diego Rivera's great mural and just ripped it to pieces because of what it said. It had a message. All right? Now, abstract art, I don't care. You could make up a message. You need a book for some of these things. You have to read an entire book to find out what they mean. Rockwell Kent said, if a work of art has to be explained, then it's probably not a good work of art.
Wow.
So I follow in a tradition with some pretty heavy hitters on my side, but they have left me a little bit out in the wilderness, and now I think I have a chance of making a difference in art. I really do. I think this movie has opened the eyes of many people. I know it from the articles that have been written. I mean, I don't know any movie that's been as widely written about as this one. This New York Times, the Wall Street Journal, the Observer, the Post, and just today the Washington Post. I mean, and there's over 60 articles now about this one movie, and this is a documentary. It's not like a And you remember what happened to Morley Safer, my good friend Morley Safer, when he did a short segment on the art world and, questioning some of the things like Jeff Koons and all that kind of stuff. And the New York Times immediately, they hired Mr. Kimmelman, who I don't think knows much about art in general, but he came up and did a nice hatchet job on Morley Safer, and then Charlie Rose did the same thing. Another hatchet job, and he might not have known what, but he had four or five people who were, we can't let Morley, he had too much presence out there with the public. And Morley told me that probably 35 million people saw his piece that was, pointing out these, and it was the most widely, it was the show that got more write-ups about it, and this is the kind of thing, but the art world, they came down on him like a ton of bricks, and I call it the art mafia. The art mafia does exist, and believe me, when you can sell a piece of canvas for $50 million, you know that if you toy around with it too much, you're going to get you're going to get slapped around a little bit. So we'll see what happens with the film.
All right, for Morley Safer now, and to me, 60 Minutes represents integrity in journalism, at its best. 60 Minutes at its best, with Dan Rather and Mike Wallace, and who spoke truth to power more than these guys, so that's fabulous. Now I want to just turn around here, Robert, and take a look at the canvas. Maybe we could stand up and actually engage the canvas of this particular work, because I think it's important to actually engage with a work of art and so our audience can see. And maybe you could explain a little bit about what's going on here and what is it that you painted and what is it and why and what the meaning is to you now.
All right, so this is one, this would be as probably closer to a something commercial, in the sense that I was asked to incorporate logos with real people in a painting that was about prohibition, about the end of prohibition. So I call it it's called Amendment 21. So, as in many of my paintings, I have little side jokes, and so in doing it, okay. So that, number one, to put this many figures in a canvas is one of the harder things to do.
This is a bar,
and this is created. Yeah, this is the Freedom Bar. No, this is the Freedom Bar. This is he's why we have bars today.
Prohibition.
Okay. And I will always drink to that. And so this is a, you know, having been in a lot of bars, I guess I was able to pick up little things from like the shuffleboard table from PJ. That's not PJ Carney's. That's Nancy Whiskey Pub. I don't want to. PJ Carney's has these wonderful. They have a wonderful bar behind. I got some things from there. I got some things out of Toad Hall, and I got some things from the Broom Street Bar. Little elements there, but the main thing is that I've incorporating like Captain Morgan. Next to, you know, I mean, I when I painted it, and I got a little Shakespeare in there because he was because Shakespeare is actually on some weird bottle of scotch that I found. So I did a lot of research, and a lot of these scotches and bourbons don't exist anymore, but they did at the time I painted it. So, you know, a little bit of humor, a little bit of color, and people always fascinate me. And so, a bar situation is just one of my favorite topics, actually.
So let's just finish. We could sit down. We got about 5 minutes left, and I hope this is just the beginning, Robert, for our relationship and our dialogue here. And just to say, you're always invited back on our show. The name of our show is called The Public Voice Salon, because we're intrigued by this concept of salon. We think it's very important to get people together for dialogue face-to-face, whether it's one-on-one or whether it's a group situation. We began our show 5 years ago. Now it's actually going on 6 years at the Symposia Bookstore in Hoboken, where we had citizen dialogues, sitting in a circle, just riffing about the important topics of our time. And we would very often have artists as a part of that dialogue, writers, painters, and just in a sort of random kind of a conversation of the kind that would happen at a bar or a cafe. We're very concerned with the kind of lack of discussion in public places. I wanted to say to you that there is a critic or a theorist, a literary theorist named Mikhail Bakhtin, whose work is very important to me. And in fact, his book on Dostoevsky is actually by my bedside. And Bakhtin was a champion of the carnivalesque spirit of this dialogue in public and spirit of fun and humor that permeates literature, in particular certain novelists like Cervantes and Dostoevsky and Shakespeare. And I find a lot of that, not to get too up in the literary realm of high theory, but that to me, your work is very indicative of that. And there is a moral feeling that I get of interconnection, of community. So maybe you could respond to that.
Well, I see myself as a historical painter, because I paint what's around me. And what I find ironic is that because I started my career right when the kind of art that was being promoted was art that really negated any kind of form that you could recognize, like a face, like a car, like a, you know, it would be kind of hard, you know, it's kind of weird when you think of it. So because of that, there haven't been many faces. I mean, how many thousands of faces I must have had, heads I've been, people I've painted over the years. And this is at a time when you could name all your top artists of this period, and there are no people, because you know, if you're pouring paint out of a can, it's pretty hard to get the detail of someone's nose or their you know. So I think simply by rejecting that part of the marketplace and saying, well, you know, that might be what's in, but that's not what interests me as a painter. What interests me is what's happening, what's going on, whether it's sports, whether it's art itself, whether it's money, whether it's sex, whether it's still lives, portraiture, all of that interests me. So I think just by that interest and saying, okay, I'm going to paint what's around me, I might, that's really what Bruegel did. It's what Vermeer did. It's what, you just go through the ages, and all of a sudden there's this. So now I look like I'm unique because I paint people. Right now they're discovering, here's a guy that paints people. Can you imagine that? Wow. How strange.
Oh, Robert, you're a great humanitarian and artist, and I want to toast to the end of Prohibition.
Absolutely.
And also a toast to you, Robert, and to this wonderful film, The Art Bastard, which is packing them in at the Angelica Cinema, where your work is now on display throughout the lobby of that cinema and going around the country. Good luck to you, sir. Good luck with your work. And thank you for the joy that your work brings to all of us. Thank you.
Well, I'm glad to know about your show, and I hope I get back on it often because, you know, being able to, freedom of speech is so rare, and so I really enjoyed talking, and I'm sure there's going to be many more things to talk about, especially about the art world in the near future.
Wow. Well, in the words of Frank Sinatra, who comes from Hoboken, where we live, the best is yet to come. Onward and upward. Thank you.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you.